Thank you, and thank you all organizers for inviting me. I've been really enjoying it. Okay, so I'm going to talk about fragility of leaf-lice intersections. This is joint with Victor. Okay, so let me just start with briefly reminding us what this question of leaf-lice intersections is about. So we have a symplectic manifold and a quasitropic submanifold. Okay, so let's say it's a 2n minus k dimensional quasitropic submanifold. And the characteristic foliation on M is, so when you restrict the symplectic form to M, it's going to have a kernel. So let's write it this way. And the characteristic foliation is the foliation whose leaves are tangent to these directions. Okay, so let me denote it by L sub M. So this is the characteristic foliation. Okay. So some examples to keep in mind, for instance, M is a Lagrangian or M is a hypersurface. Now the question, maybe before that, let me also set up the notation. So there will be a Hamiltonian diffeomorphism of W. So, okay, so the question of leaf-wise intersections is the following thing. So, let's call them leaf-wise intersections. So, we are asking if there exists a leaf of the this foliation so that phi of this leaf and the leaf itself intersects. So is there a leaf, let's call it L, of this such that phi of L intersected with L is non-empty. Okay. So that brings me to the definition that I want to say. So a leaf-wise intersection point, then let's call it Z, is a leaf-wise intersection point that's going to be of M and phi of M. Okay. So if it is in the intersection of the two things, plus it's on the same leaf of the characteristic foliation. Okay, so if Z and phi of Z lie on the same leaf. Okay, so we don't expect this thing to be true always. Of course, for instance, if you take R2N, you can, if your Hamiltonian diffeomorphism is far from identity, you can just displace everything. So you don't need to have leaf-wise intersections. So usually one needs to assume something to prove the existence of or persistence of leaf-wise intersections. So you need to need not be true. This is one thing. Okay. Need to assume something. And usually, these are assumptions on the submanifold and or the size of the Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. So on M or on phi. Okay. So already, if you look at one special case, like for instance, M is a Lagrangian, we have Lagrangian intersection results. Right, in general, you need to have something like phi is sufficiently close to the identity. Okay. In fact, the Lagrangian intersections, the motivation to study the problem, it just generalizes the case of the Lagrangian intersections. Okay, so all right. So what do I want to say next? So I want to say next is the following thing. So the leafwise intersections, let me go back to the origin of the problem, was first addressed by Moser. So namely, Moser proved the following thing. So he proved that if the diffeomorphism is C1 close to the identity, then you have, so when I write an intersection of this form, I mean leafwise intersection, not the coisotropic intersection. So this is non-empty. This is for any close coisotropic submanifold. And in fact, you have a number of intersections here, not just one, but this is all governed by, you know, loose direction Riemann type theories, basically. So this is Moser's result. And the proof of this is similar to the Lagrangian case, which is due to Weinstein. So you basically, this is a very important assumption here. You look at the graph of defoliation and try to look at the intersections of it with phi of the phi identity phi of the diagonal, basically. So, and then you turn it into a Lagrangian problem, roughly speaking. One has to be careful here, of course, but this is how it works, and you can prove this result using the Lagrangian theorem. So this result recently has been extended by Ziltener, and this is, for now I'm going to quote him, but I will come back to Ziltener's result, and he proved that you can, if you have an isotopy which stays C0 close to the identity, in fact he does it like stronger form of this, then you have, again, you have a number of intersections, the same result. Okay. As I said, I'm going to come back to Ziltener result. The point maybe I want to emphasize here is that these are any quasi-tropic submanifolds with no assumptions on M here. Now, in another direction, so in fact, the first result after Moser was Hofer's theorem. This is what I want to come back to, mention here. And Hofer proved the following thing. So if you have a restricted contact type hypersurface, and if the your phi is small in Hofer norm, let me denote it like this. Small. Okay. Then you have the leafwise intersections. So usually, actually, this kind of results, when you're looking for this, you're also looking for an upper bound on the norm of phi. So this result, for instance, says that you have intersections for as long as the norm is smaller than a certain symplectic capacity, so which is like your persistence, basically, of the intersections. So, all right, so many people have studied this question. A number of them are in this room, more along the lines of Hofer. So this result has been extended to other symplectic manifolds has been extended in a variety of ways, let me put it this way. But for me, so I'm going to just write here, plus others. So the result that I want to stick to here today, the Moser and the Hofer result, and the two comparison between the two is just here you have this, you know, strong assumption on the size of phi, no assumptions on m. Here, rather light assumption on the size of phi, a strong assumption on m. Okay. All right. So now maybe it's time to get to the main result. One of the things, questions, of course, was that how much of these assumptions on M is necessary in Hofer's result and all the results pretty much along these lines. So do we need to assume any of this is, was the question. So here's the theorem. I'll write it as theorem one. And it says that indeed you do need to assume something on M. So here's the statement. So there exists a closed smooth hypersurface. M in R2n greater or equal to 4. And a sequence of smooth Hamiltonians so I'll write this as f sub k c0 converging to 0 all supported in the same compact set such that the intersection of the hypersurface, again, leafwise intersections, with phi of m is empty. So phi f sub k, the Hamiltonian diffeomorphism generated by these Hamiltonians. OK? All right. So let me make a number of remarks here. This hypersurface is clearly not of contact type by Hofer's result. Let's put it this way. In fact, it's not even stable, which is the weaker type of requirements when one considers this kind of question. So the weakest of all is stability, and this is not even stable. Again, what follows from the proof is that it's diffeomorphic to the sphere, the standard round sphere. It's C0 close to it, arbitrarily C0 close to it. And these, these Hamiltonians are supported in an arbitrarily small neighborhoods of the sphere. So everything is happening in the neighborhood of the sphere, basically. So this is the theorem that I wanted to talk about today. So maybe I want to go back to this Ziltner result and just look at the two things together. Here's another thing that this shows. It shows that, for instance, in the Ziltner theorem, you cannot expect to possibly relax it further and assume that this is Hofer's mole, basically. And on the opposite side, a rather obvious remark, but let me make it, we couldn't possibly expect this to be a C1 close to 0 again, this time by Ziltner again. So I just wanted to say the following thing, probably, that right now, these two sort of results, I think, really seem to capture what is, in a way, the best and the worst you can expect if you don't assume anything on the manifold, basically. So this is probably not going to get any better, and this probably is as bad as it gets, or as good as it gets, depending on how you want to see it. OK. So I mean, there are still some you know, other questions one can still ask under stability assumption with small Hofer norm if you have leafwise intersections. There are questions, so I'm not saying that all questions has been answered or anything like that, but this is already, I think that the two together is pretty good. So there's one more thing that, so I'm going to talk about the proof of this, but I want to mention another theorem, which is essentially a corollary of this theorem, but it's sort of related to a different area of symplectic topology, which is this C0 symplectic topology. So let me just write this too. And so it says the following thing, basically these hypersurfaces we are having. So there exists a sequence of closed smooth hypersurfaces in R2N, smoothly embedded. Okay. Hamiltonianly diffeomorphic to each other. Okay. And which converge to the standard spheres, round sphere. Yeah, to a minus one. Okay. But if you look at the characteristic foliations, keeping the notation from there, if you look at the characteristic foliations on these hypersurfaces, they don't converge in any reasonable sense to the Hopf vibration, which is the foliation on the sphere. Okay. So as I said, this is kind of related to the C0 symplectic topology. Business a little bit. So one of the, actually, this is also a quasi-tropic question. One of the questions there is that, let's say you have a sequence of quasi-tropic submanifolds, C0 converging to another manifold, then is it true that the result is quasi-tropic? So this is not known. So of course, it may be reasonable to, I mean, there is no counterexample to this question I just stated, but it may be reasonable to even ask the question assuming that, let's suppose the sequence of these quasi-tropic submanifolds are stable, contact type, restricted contact type, I don't know. And then what is the result? Or you can assume, just as it is related to here, that they are Hamiltonian diffeomorphic to each other. In this, so there is a situation, for instance, if you have hypersurfaces, the limit is going to be quasi-tropic. And let's suppose that they're also Hamiltonian diffeomorphic. Here was a question whether the foliations converge to the foliations on here converge to the limit foliation. And in fact, a recent result of Humilier, Leclerc, Seyfettini, also an early result of Obstein, shows that if the map between these submanifolds converge to a homeomorphism, the answer is yes. The foliations converge, the result is quasi-tropic, etc. So, but this, what this shows is that if you don't assume anything on M, or that these maps don't converge to a homeomorphism, which our maps don't, you don't have to have the foliations converging in any reasonable sense at all. Okay? So what happens here actually is that, I mean, we have a sequence of curves. Again, if I get to prove this, you're going to see that they converge to a simple closed curve on the sphere, which is nowhere tangent to the characteristic foliation on the sphere. So that's basically the proof. Okay, and right, so this is basically the situation. So what I want to do now is to talk about the proofs. One has to only prove theorem one. Of course, the theorem two is you get hypersurfaces by from here, by looking at the images here. All right, so okay, so the proof of this result, the main ingredient of this result is a concept which is called a plug, which will be a symplectic plug in my case, which has been traditionally used to construct hypersurfaces with no closed characteristics. So you what you would do, you start with plugs. Traditional usage is you start with finitely many closed characteristics, and you use this construction to break these closed orbits, basically. Okay, so and the same type of construction here can be used to get rid of the leafwise intersections, basically. Okay, so as I said, the main thing is this thing called the symplectic plug. Before I get to maybe to the symplectic plug, let me just briefly tell you what I am going to be doing, just the idea of the proof. So what we will do is we will start with the standard sphere. Let's also just assume everything is happening in four dimensions, because the higher dimensional case is easily, you generalize everything here. So I want to take a Hamiltonian which is supported near the sphere, and it will be just a the corresponding Hamiltonian diffeomorphism will just translate the sphere a little bit in an epsilon direction, in one direction, epsilon away. So here's, let me just sketch it. Let's say this is P1, Q1. All right. I want to now shift this a little bit. So so what I started with is just one leaf of the characteristic foliation. This is a unit circle. I'm projecting it on the P1, Q1 plane. So I am in S3 in R4 with coordinates, P2, Q2. OK. So I take F tilde, which is some epsilon times some cutoff function P1, so this is cutoff identical to one near, it will be supported near S3. So the corresponding Hamiltonian diffeomorphism is just parallel transport by this vector. Let's write it this way. Okay, so this is what's happening here. Okay, so now look at the leafwise intersections here. So you have S3 intersected with this. So the things you're going to get are, it's a bad picture. Let me try to do a nicer one. So they are actually going to be the following guys. So if you remember my definition, so it's these points. Let me call it z plus and z minus. OK, so I shift this sphere. Let me call this, the circle in this direction. All right. So this is a leafwise intersection because phi of this is both in the image and both in the diff and in the image of the same diff. Okay. So then the idea is that what I want to do, so this is going to be my north pole, and this is going to the to correspond to the south pole with coordinates 1, 0, 0. What I want to do, I want to just take this thing and insert near a flow box here at this point. And I'll do the same thing here. And the resulting thing is going to look like the following. So something will be in this way. Now, what this is going to do is that it's going to split this characteristic into two parts. So now you will no longer have these guys being on the same leaf because it's been parted from each other, basically. So this is going to be m. Let's call it m equals to m1. Okay, very good. So you have to be careful while inserting these plugs. What you want, of course, it should be away from these leaf-wise intersection points. It should be displaced by the Hamiltonian. And it shouldn't intersect the shifted circle, shifted sphere. Okay? So as a result, you get a hypersurface like the one that I just sketched. And this is, of course, C0 close to the S3 you started with. And the only way it's just a perturbation in this, inside these little neighborhoods of the North Pole and the South Pole. OK, so no longer you have leaf-wise intersections in this thing. So now what you want to do, you want to take this construction. And you want to apply it for a sequence of epsilon k's. So okay, to epsilon k going to 0. As a result, we are going to get a sequence of perturbations of the sphere. So these are, this time, of course, I'm going to have, and the Hamiltonians Fk tilde is epsilon k, again, this cutoff p1, all the same way. And I'm going to have this sequence of hypersurfaces such that we have no leaf-wise intersections here. OK, now this is all good, but there comes a crucial step. And the crucial step is, so see what I'm doing here is that I'm making this epsilon smaller and small, and what I wanted to do is that we need to prove that these plugs can be inserted in a way that all these m sub k's are Hamiltonian diffeomorphic to each other. Okay, so one needs to prove that there exists a sequence of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. Okay, so I'll write it as an eta sub k. Everything is a local construction here. Which sends your, so this was my first hypersurface right here, sends it to the kth one. Okay? And the support, all of these will be in the same subset, just as I was telling in the neighborhood. So we have this, let's look at this thing here. I'm going to just sketch it like that. So I have this perturbation. Okay? So I want to just lower this YA sequence, basically. OK, so what we need to do is we need to find this smaller and smaller flux which we can sort of Hamiltonian map into each other. Okay? So, okay, one has to do this. Let's suppose we did that. Once we did that, you're going to take F sub k as this composition. These will also be these are also going to be supporting the same compact set, and you will be done pretty much. Sort of, this will give you all the hypersurfaces and everything claimed in the theorem. So this is basically the main thing that one has to do after constructing this plug, basically. So this is the heart of the method, I should say, that, that you can do this, basically. Okay, so now I want to tell you actually what is what here a little bit. Some details. Okay, so I've got to start from with a plug, and the one that I'm going to describe is tailored for this proof, tailored to the proof of this theorem. So let me just set some notation here. So pi is the following rectangle. Okay, so this is will be my x and t coordinates for some delta and t positive. And I'm going to think of this equipped with the symplectic form dx dt. And p will be circle times this rectangle. And so this I'm going to have theta coordinates. And I'm going to also set B, a four-dimensional object. This is actually going to be going to get embedded into a neighborhood of here, of the North Pole and the South Pole. Okay, so B cross minus AA. Again, here for some A, positive. Okay. And let me give the coordinate y here. And I want to think of this four-dimensional object as a symplectic object equipped with the symplectic form. Let's write it as sigma dx. I have dx dt from there plus dy dt. OK? OK. Now let me take two functions on this rectangle pi. They are supposed to satisfy a bunch of properties, and this is what's going to, you know, give us all the properties we want from the characteristic flow inside this plug thing. Okay, so let me write it just like that. So I want h to be x and f to be 0 near the boundary. Okay, so C0 norm here is less than a and k less or equal to delta here. And then another important one is the x derivative in the x direction. This is always positive, and h0t is, this is not very essential but useful. This is essential though. And I want the critical points of this function h, p plus minus, that these are going to be happening at these points. And at these points, exactly the x derivative of the f function is not 0. And this is the only zeros of this derivative, otherwise it's positive. It's kind of lengthy, but I have to write it. So h is even in t, f is odd in t for every x. In particular, actually, I have, due to this, t plus is minus t minus, tau plus is minus t minus. Okay, so picture-wise, here's what I have. At least let me try to draw the levels of h. It's very similar to the ones, standard ones. Used. So because of this, just take a look at it. H is x near the boundary. Everything is standard near the boundary. So I'm going to have these straight lines here. You can only enter from the bottom, exit from the top. Okay. And here I have a critical point. Here I have another one, p minus p plus, let's call it. And then this is my capital T. This is minus t, minus delta, delta. This is my x coordinate. And so here I have something like that. Okay, so it continues gradually becoming less and less shallow and with the symmetry. Okay, this is like that. So levels, these are the levels of h, and what you're seeing is the flow of the Hamiltonian vector field of h, basically. These functions do exist for every positive parameter, delta t and h. Okay, so here is a lemma, which follows from all these properties. So the two form, which is given by d h d theta f dt, is maximally non-degenerate. Okay, so it has rank 2. And its characteristic vector field, so you are looking at the directions of the kernel of this, and is the following object, d d theta minus h prime dt d dx plus the x derivative d dt here. So it's basically I have x, this rotational part, plus the Hamiltonian vector field for h. Basically, this is what I have here. Moreover, what I need to do, of course, I need to be able to embed all this structure, although I haven't told you what it is, into this B. So let me continue here. There exists an embedding, J, that goes from P to P minus AA. So it's getting embedded into this B I introduced over there, which is so this is in this symplectic object, which is identity and zero near the boundary. And it pulls back the symplectic form to the two form, which is called the plug two form, in this way. The proof is going to be one line, at least for this talk. Let me, in fact, write it here. Okay, so I'm going to give you the explicit embedding. So it's going to take theta, x, and t into, now that I have my functions, so theta, h, t, and minus f. Okay, so this is the y component. This is the t component of the embedding. So everything else follows from all these properties, if you just stare at them, basically. And, you know, pullbacks and does these things again. This totally follows from these properties, basically. Let me make, let's look at this a little bit more. So what do we have near the boundary of P? X is going to be equal to, so this is X, H is X and F is 0, so I'm going to have d dt near the boundary. And then what else do we have? So the local flow of X will have exactly two integral curves entirely contained in this thing. And what are these? Let's just look at the form of the functions. When you hit this critical point, I'm going to have H0, my vector field is going to be rotational, right? So I'm going to have these things. If you enter here, exit here, you always do so from the same, with the same x and theta coordinates. This is called a symmetric property. All of what I'm saying right now and not writing are actually standard, more or less standard properties that one expects from a plug. What you are trying to do, let me say the last thing as well and then say what I'm about to say. There is a trap trajectory. Namely, if you enter from here, you asymptotically approach the circle here, basically. So something that enters and doesn't exit. Okay, so the goal of this whole thing is that you want to change something here. More or less, nothing else outside. It nicely embeds into this in a flow box near the point you want to do. And you understand what's going on inside, so you are not creating new leaf-wise intersections or new closed orbits if you're going to use your plug for this business. Okay, so now let's call so such a P is a symplectic plug with this form, with this embedding and the functions, a symplectic plug, and I'm going to call this an HF plug. Okay. With this, I mean that actually all of these parameters, A, T, delta entered in this picture, which are here, plays a role. So that's what I mean. Now, here's the heart of the matter. So here's the proposition. And this proposition says the following. For every positive delta, there exists a sequence of such plugs, HK, FK. Okay. Here, delta is fixed, so this is delta, and everything else depends on K. Okay. That's what I mean in this picture. Such that TK goes to 0, AK goes to 0, and the plugs are Hamiltonianly diffeomorphic. To each other. With diffeomorphism being identity near the boundary. Okay, what I mean by this is the following thing. So these are, you can think of them as monotone decreasing sequences. I want to picture this whole thing happening in one B. In it, I'm going to have smaller and smaller things, but I'm saying is that you can map the image of one into the another one. For instance, when you have an embedding in the smaller one, right here you have a J, but then you will have J sub K. So I'm thinking of extending it to this B as identity outside. So I really have this, so in that sense, the images can map to each other, basically. So the eta K I denoted earlier, so eta K of JP is JK PK, if I'm to denote this thing as PK. So. Okay. So what I want to do, probably, I want to just tell you what is how we should think about this to begin with. So it may be helpful to just write what is sufficient to prove this thing. So on the proof, so it suffices to prove the following thing. Again, for a fixed so the beginning ones are fixed. So we want to find a sequence of functions, hk, fk, which satisfies all the plug conditions, all of these, plus they do the following thing. So the C0 norm of fk goes to 0, and if you look at the t component of hk minus x, actually, I'll write it this way. Goes to 0, okay? So for some sequence of tk's, and such that all plugs are diffeomorphic. And all these plugs are diffeomorphic. Okay, so what's going on here? So what do I want to do is the following thing. So I want this hypersurfaces be as close to the sphere as possible, right? So, but I don't want them to be intersecting. So the y coordinate is, where is my y coordinate? The last one here, over here. It actually tells me how much room it occupies in this four-dimensional thing. Okay, so I want to make this as small as I want. And that literally corresponds to this, basically. That's how we should think. So this is the, I want to make the t component as small as I want. So the places that this hk deviates from the identity should be small. So then what's going to happen is that, so I'm going to just sort of shrink this thing, basically. Okay, so I want this, what is it called? If I am to think of this as something like that, okay, so this being this pi piece here, tx, I want the shorter and shorter things so that I'm close to I'm saying the wrong thing, sorry. The first piece has to do with, the first piece has to do with being able to close to the sphere, and the other one has to do with being shorter and shorter, and so I can displace them, basically. Okay? Right? So when I move my sphere, I can displace the whole thing. Okay? So the proof, we'll go along the following lines. So first one, we're going to fix h. I'm not sure I'm going to be able to tell much. But you're going to, we're going to consider a sequence of f's, sort of, depending on a parameter s. So I'm going to try to lower this cap to make the C0 norm as small as I want, not touching h at all. Okay. All right, so this is one part of the proof. And then the second part, making this t part small, is going to be rather easy because this you can get just by doing the, you just do an hyperbolic transformation in the t y plane, basically. Okay. Okay. So what does it come down to? a few words in the remaining 10 minutes. As I said, I'm going to have this JSS. So now everything will be this parameter depending, otherwise you just have, so I'll have FS, and therefore I'm going to have a JS, right, over there. And then I'm going to have omega S, which is just the pullback of the symplectic form, which is going to have, again, this form. Exactly. Okay. So what we want is, remember, I'm trying to do this thing simultaneously, diffeomorphic to each other. So the goal is that actually to find an S-dependent Hamiltonian, ultimately, let's call it Ks on B, which is with the following properties. So KSJ is the composition of JS psi S from B to B for an isotopy, for some isotopy of P, which is identity near the boundary. And this is 0 near the boundary. Okay. I need this Hamiltonian to be able to show that, you know, that these things are Hamiltonian diffeomorphic. So what boils down to is proving something like that. Okay. So to be able to, so what I have is that this family of embedded hypersurfaces, I want to realize them as gotten as the images of a Hamiltonian isotopy from my original P. So put P in here, so I'm going to get them from that. Okay. So the first thing to do this, one necessary condition for this is that, well, you need to have this isotopy which pulls back these symplectic forms omega s to the standard one. So first you need to do this. So have this isotopy, basically, such that P. Okay. And we do this by finding a generating vector field for ZS. Okay. Now, we have a formula for this, So it tells us basically that this should be of the following form. For some unknown function g on this pi thing, it should be something like that. And then you write down all your equations. What you arrive at is the following thing. To be able to find this isotopy, you need to solve the following. This is, again, in betweeners calculating. You need to solve the following Cauchy problem. So this is the Hamiltonian vector field. This is your unknown function. And this is dds of the x derivative of this s. Sorry, let me write it this way, not to make it more confusing. OK? This right-hand side will be 0 in neighborhoods of my critical points. Now, everything would be nice if I didn't have zeros of this guy. So this is actually a singular Cauchy problem. Okay? And this function should be such that it is 0 near the boundary. Okay? So I guess if you go back to the picture I just erased in this rectangle, you can solve this starting with an initial condition g equals to 0 here, which is what it should be, all the way you hit this first critical point, okay? And then you extend it. So what you need to do is actually, you need to show that this is smooth. This is a solution of this Cauchy-Riemann problem, okay? So which is sort of, you you come near this critical point, use the fact that the right-hand side's zero, you have a homogeneous solution here, and then go from here to including a neighborhood extended, which you can do by just, it's a homogeneous equation by just assigning it to be the constant solution along the integral curves. And then you need to show that it is actually as smooth as what you started with as the initial conditions. Okay, so this is like the part of the issue one needs to deal with, showing the existence and the smoothness of this solution. The next thing you need to do, now you solved your Z and you created your isotopy, you need to actually, well, you need a Hamiltonian, right? In order to do this, well, you have a candidate for your Hamiltonian vector field, and this vector field along your embeddings to get, let's write for K sub S, okay? So showing that the forms are diffeomorphic is the first step, but then you need to find the Hamiltonian, and this candidate JS psi S actually is along the hypersurfaces, embedded hypersurfaces, is the Hamiltonian vector field for this. And then you start with this, and then you reduce the problem showing that the form, like when you pull things back all the way to P, you need to show that this is exact to have the Hamiltonian. You need to argue a little, this is not simply connected, so you need to go through that part of the work. And when you do this, you are almost there. Your last step is going to be, as I said, what this step is rather non-trivial step buys you the following thing. If you start with HF, you can go to HF tilde where F tilde has arbitrarily small C0 norm. Now you need to make this this TK going to zero. So for this, you go to your TY plane and do a hyperbolic transformation. And well, when you do this transformation, of course, you're going to shrink the T component as much as you want. This is going to expand the Y component, but it won't matter because I've already shown independently that I can make the Y component as small as I want. So in fact, you would first make the Y component small and then do the hyperbolic transportation. It will expand a little bit your Y component, but again, you have under control because of this first part of the thing you have proved. I think I'm going to stop here.